be happy, 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 happy. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for your presence here today. We're very glad to have you. Take it!
Bye.
Take it!
Bye.
Take Nigeria!
Bye.
Take our lives!
Bye.
Take our destinies!
Bye.
It's time to wrench our destinies back from the brigands who are currently ruling Nigeria. Let them know that we mean business. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We're here for the fundraising here in the Dallas Fort Metroplex. My name is Pamela Olodi. I'll be comparing the event for tonight. Before we start, we will have opening prayer from one of our Christian brothers and another from our Muslim brother, and then we'll have a national anthem. For the Christian prayer, I want to call on Dr. Daniel to come and give us a prayer, please. Thank you so much. Please help usher him here.
Okay.
AAC.
Take it back.
That is great, because you cannot take it back without action.
Yes,
tonight we are grateful to receive here our own president, because we have to proclaim faith is something that speaks those things that are not as though they were. So we are proclaiming and professing into the future. You have to speak it until it begins to happen.
Yes.
So do not see your mouth while you do action. I also want you to speak. Speak to somebody, speak on the destiny of Nigeria, speak on the destiny of Africa. I so much believe that as much as we speak, it is going to begin to resonate and it's going to bring the change. So let us honor God by standing over our feet as we pray tonight to get this occasion started. I'm excited to be here. Do not bother about the number. We are full in this place. I have the faith that we are full in this place. And the Spirit of the Lord is going to be with us tonight, and we're going to do great things. Let us pray. Father, we want to thank you for tonight. First of all, we are humble for the fact that you have given us life, and you have made it possible for us to be here, to gather here as brothers and sisters. Lord, as people that have taken the business of our country serious, because we know that one day you're going to ask us an account of what we did with Nigeria, of what we did with a lovely country that you gave to us. And Lord God, you look upon us as custodians. And therefore tonight, Lord, we owe you the responsibility to conduct the business of Nigeria in the way it should be. Father, we thank you for life. And Lord, we want to thank you once more for bringing our president here. Lord, from the foundation of the earth, you have chosen him. Even as you said concerning Jeremiah, that I called you to be my prophet even before you were formed in your mother's womb. Lord, you know, Father, Lord, whatever that we do, Father, from creation, you know everything about him. And at this point, oh God, we want to thank you, because you have raised him, oh God, Father, to be a leader. And Lord, we are standing shoulder with him, oh God, putting energy and force behind him, that may you use him to fulfill the destiny for which you created him for. And therefore, for that reason, we want to thank you for his life. We want to thank you for protecting him and his crew that flew all the way from Nigeria to this place. Father, we want to pray that you that have made it possible for him to be here, Father, is going to also make it possible that his being here will be positive in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Lord, I speak tonight that God, that which you have given into his hand, that mantle will not fall until it has fulfilled the purpose for which you gave him. Father, Lord, we might look that, oh God, he is young. We might even think that we don't have, Father, Lord, the population, the votes, all the voices that it takes. But we know that one with you is majority. When you decree a thing, oh God, it is certain. When you say yes, nobody can say no. When you say no, nobody can say yes. We are not going into this just as men. We are going with the force of God. We are going with the force of heaven. We are going, oh God, Father, we are backing. We said, back, Shore, oh God. Back, Shore, oh God. Back, Shore.
trust in chariots, but we shall put our trust in the name of the Lord. Amen. He will come with you and he will conquer. Amen. He will come with you and he will rule. Amen. He will come with you and he will have victory. Amen. In the name of Jesus, amen. Multiply the voices, multiply the votes. Amen. Lord, open doors and make his path to Aso Rock to be clear, to be clear, to be clear, to be clear. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Bless this meeting tonight. Make it a miraculous one and one that we shall live, Father, to reckon with. We give you the glory and the praise. We declare this vocation open. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen. We give thanks to Almighty Allah for giving us a safe journey to, for everybody to be here. Representative, the man, the reason why we are here, the man of the moment. We pray Allah, mercy, protection be over you. Being in Nigeria, we know it's not an easy job, but you went to the north, to the south, east, west, and may Allah continue to guide you. I'll recite Surah Al-Fatiha, because for every Muslim and for every prayer five times daily, that is one critical surah in Islam. And we know whenever the ayah is recited, the mercy of Allah, the blessing, is there for everyone. And please just say Amen at the end of my recitation. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Maliki Yawmiddin. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ihdina siratal mustaqim. Ihdina siratal mustaqim. Ihdina siratal mustaqim. Allah is the guardian. He shall guide you through all your journey to make that presidency for the unborn generation of Nigeria. Siratul lazina alayhim ta'alayhim. Gairil maqdubi alayhim wa ladolim. Amen.
Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, please let's rise for the singing of National Anthem of Nigeria. Appreciate you being here today. Before we go further, just want to recognize people who worked very assiduously to put this together. I'll call some names, and please rise and just take a bow and be acknowledged by the room. The first person is Mr. Femi Bitayo. Mr. Femi Bitayo, thank you so much. Thank you. Next person is Ms. Christina Bitayo. Thank you so much for coming. We appreciate you. Dr. Chidi Ogota, he's the Yimo State Governor, gubernatorial candidate for AAC. And then Victor Adeyemi. Thank you so much for coming. Mrs. Mary Adeyemi.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. And Chief Williams Kenana. I hope I pronounced that correct.
Welcome.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Because I want you all to be cognizant of the fact that this is not a trivial thing being here. It's a Friday night in Dallas. It's a fun city, quite honest to be. And we chose purposely to be here. And that's because we acknowledge the weight of what we're doing here today. The state of Nigeria is not a good one. The state of Nigeria is not a good one. I was looking up, you know, some information as a prelude to this, and there's something called Human Development Index. So it's about, you know, the education, educational attainment of people in the country, the status of the health of the people, as well as, you know, GDP per capita. So of a total of 198 countries, Nigeria is 157. When I looked at the people in the vicinity, they were puny countries. I don't say puny to deride them. It's just that relatively they're small, you know, lacking natural resources. So Nigeria shouldn't be swimming in those waters at all, right? Yes. What the politicians count on is our docility. They expect us to be docile. They expect us to be chasing banalities, you know, things that are so trivial. It's the latest dance fad, or is it Chelsea versus Man U? They count on that a lot. Whereas our lives, our kids' lives have been wasted away. There's willful pillaging going on in Nigeria, ladies and gentlemen. So let's not trivialize what's going on here. Look at our peer countries. India, right? We were colonized by the British. They don't want to wait, you know, to be in perpetual servitude of these people. The man I'm about to introduce right now, I've known him for about 20 years. He was student union president at the University of Lagos a couple of years before I did. And the history, the antecedents he left behind that I got when I got into office, marked him out as a future leader of men. And it's time for us to sweep away that garbage about him not being experienced. Experienced in what exactly? Experienced in stealing people's money and putting 1,000 naira bill under plastic so that people can vote for you. Our kids' lives are at stake. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Moyo Adesuwore, a fantastic activist, leader of men, entrepreneur, a solid Nigerian citizen who's been there every step of the way in fighting for a better Nigeria. Welcome him with me, please, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much. Thank you, Mr. Moyo Adesuwore. We're so glad to have you back. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. Please have a seat. I'm not going to bore you too much tonight because this is my third time in Dallas, actually. First time we were here was a fundraiser. Second time it was a fundraiser. Now it's the third time it's a fundraiser. So probably Dallas is going to become the capital of Nigeria when we win next year. You raised too much funds to liberate Nigeria. You deserve something big. I'm here today, directly flew in from Nigeria this morning. And it was at the tail end of a trip to the southeastern part of Nigeria where we went to Enugu. And from Enugu, we went to Onitsha. From Onitsha, we went Aba. And briefly stopped in Owerri. And one of the beautiful things when we were in Owerri was the banner of our governorship candidate, Dr. Chidi, who is in your midst here. You know? And they were asking for her, you know, when are we going to see our governorship candidate? We had to tell them that she's waiting in Dallas for us to have this fundraiser, and then she'll fly directly to Nigeria to commence her campaign. You know all the statistics. Last few days, Nigeria got some promotion again in the wrong direction. Nigeria has become the country now where a child is likely to die before the age of 5. That's the country that Nigeria is. Nigeria recently became the world poverty capital, taken over from India. And yesterday, there's another addition to that. Nigeria became the third, the world most terrorized country in the world. It's number 3. That is behind Afghanistan, I think Somalia. Nigeria is now number 3. So that is what we are here to change. And I don't need to tell you, we are up against very, very powerful forces. They are not powerful because they have ideas. They are not powerful because they are driven by any particular mission. They are not powerful because they are driven by, because they are visionary. They are powerful because they have had a chance to loot the treasury of Nigeria over the last 58 years and keep that money over the years, over these years, and give a fraction of it on election day to our people. So in Nigeria, the law says that you cannot spend more than, I think, 1 billion naira for the election, otherwise you have to report your spending. At an average rally that they've had, two of the major political parties have had 2 rallies each, I think maybe 3 for the People's Democratic Party, and 1 is in Kano today for the APC, that's the All Progressives Congress. And they call them All Progressives and All Present Criminals in Nigeria. So forgive me if I don't know what to call them. They spend an average of 1 billion naira per rally. That is what they spend. And this is not from their own money, they are using state resources and using them to bribe people. But everything you see that's happening in Nigeria in terms of all the negativities that you read about, they are all planned to make Nigeria look the way it is today. In fact, I think one thing you have to give to Nigerian politicians, the current crop of politicians, is that they have done a very great job of pauperizing the Nigerian people. They have pummeled them over the years, they've stripped them of any form of dignity, such that when it is time for them to have a rally of this nature, it's easy to rent people to come en masse to a stadium and say, hey, let's meet at the stadium. We want to teach you how to suffer more. You know, and they pay them a little, you know, some peanuts, and people will come en masse. Is the argument we are having now today is that people, if you meet an average Nigerian, they will say, we don't want the candidate of the APC, that is our ancestor, Muhammadu Buhari, who is president now. And they will tell you, we don't want Atiku, who is also a thief, well known, documented by the US Senate. For those of you who live here, you can read up on how he collected $40 million through bribery schemes through one of his houses in Potomac, D.C. And they'll say to you, we want a young person with fresh ideas. And you ask them, of course, they'll tell you your candidate, the man standing in front of you today. But they're also very quick to say, well, he doesn't have money to give us, to bribe us, so that we can vote for him. Oh, we don't think he can win because he can't match these thieves. But the question we keep asking them is, for how long will these thieves ruin your lives before you realize that it's too late? We traveled around Nigeria. We did 100 events or more before they lifted the ban of campaign officially a few weeks ago. And since they started, since they lifted the ban on campaign, we've also gone back on the road again, especially in the northwestern part of Nigeria, where we traveled to Jigawa, entry into President Buhari's hometown at about 8 p.m. one day. The place is in darkness. And when we were entering the city, people were traveling with us. We traveled with about a 30-man crew. They were all scared. They said, well, finally, these people are going to butcher us. Because this is Buhari's hometown. This is territory. You have come to step on the tail of the tiger. And I told them there's no tiger anywhere. These people are probably more disappointed in Buhari than you are. Lo and behold, when we walked into that city, the young people there were shouting, following us. They gave us another name. They called him Sebaba. Yes, and he started saying Sebobo. Which is that, and I addressed them very quickly. I said, look, your Baba is tired. He needs to come back home and retire. And they were very happy. In fact, they were asking us to come back the next day because they kept screaming, Buhari has failed, Buhari is finished. So Atiku is also not willing because they have nothing to run on. They have no ideas to sell to Nigerian people. What they are doing right before our very eyes, they use their proxies to come and do debates. You know, sometimes debates are so puerile. You think you are watching a high school debate between two kids, you know, like in a cat fight. There is nothing in those ideas that, you know, will show that these guys are, even through their proxies, they have no ideas to sell. In fact, we found out during our research that Buhari stole the logo of his Next Level from Next Year. I think they have another company in the US they stole the logo from. They steal our ideas every day. Every day, these guys are always stealing anything. Everything I'm saying here tonight, they're watching. That's the good news. And by tomorrow, they are going to try to do something that I'm saying here. You know, when we spoke about minimum wage, they stole the idea. But they still can't pay minimum wage of 30,000 naira. 30,000 naira is how much in dollars? Ladies and gentlemen, my maths is no longer as good as it used to be. Formally, what is 30,000?
$30.
$30. That's Nigeria's monthly minimum wage. There are those of you who are sitting here who are going to get paid by sitting down here. Some of you are so lucky. You get paid $30 per hour. Yes. You're not going to work, but you're sitting down here, but somehow because of your skill set, you get paid even when you are asleep, you know. That is the salary of a Nigerian worker per month, not per hour. Per month. South Africa is doing better than us, but South Africa has moved on to 126,000 naira per month. And our proposal is for 100,000. As Pomile mentioned here, Nigeria is the only country in the world that is doing as bad as it's doing in any category of countries with the same amount of resource available to Nigeria. Do you understand? So we are number six largest producer of oil in the world. Angola, that's the first 20 years of war, is doing better than Nigeria. And they are probably the same amount of production levels with us. Saudi Arabia started producing oil at the same time we produce oil. And look at what they are doing with their own. Not even, you know, Venezuela, even with their situation today, is as bad as that of Nigeria. I was doing a show because I do an evening show once in a while to raise funds. You know, we call it our time on the couch. Some of you should watch it, and those of you who don't watch it, watch that. Some guy called from Libya, you know, walked on Libya and said, I'm doing better in Libya than I would have been doing if I was in Nigeria. We have 24 hours electricity, even though we're at war. Nigeria at the time went and rescued a lot of Nigerians who were trapped in India. Half of them have returned to India, and sorry, Libya, after they were rescued. So everywhere else is better than Nigeria. But we can keep talking about how bad things are. If we don't step up and take the country back, we are wasting our time. You can do all the analysis you want. You know, you only become more paralyzed. That's what we call analysis paralysis. A lot of us are very good at it. We always analyze Nigeria's problem. Everybody who's been at home on a short vacation comes back and analyze more, you know, or you cry about it, or they stole your bag upon arrival at the airport, or you can't use a bathroom, or you couldn't even get from the airport to your house because there's traffic, because the roads are bad. Your cousins and, you know, brothers and sisters are waiting at the airport, they collect your money and disappear, you know. It's not because they want to do it, it's because the country is broken. So, but how do we fix it? We have to fix it with men who have capacity. You know, we have to replace money with ideas as a currency for engagement and leadership in the country. And we have to have people who have will, you know, because a lot of the things that we hear from you guys is that, oh, why don't all the young people who are running join hands together? With due respect, we are not the same, right? Welcome, sir. Welcome. We are not the same. A lot of the young people who are out there, who are running because some of them just want to be on the ballot. Some of them are running as proxies, as we found out, on behalf of Atiku. Some are running on behalf of Buhari. We're not the same. We don't have the same level of experience. We don't have the same level of interest. We don't have the same level of ability to engage. And we can sit down here and talk about how experienced we are. But that's not going to solve the problem. And the problem will be solved when we bring everything we have in terms of capacity and match that with vision and mission, and most importantly, action, and start to make things work. And I'll tell you before I wrap up that what we save Nigeria is to start making little things work first. You know, things that you take for granted, little things, that's my experience, you know. Like, start with education by making sure that 6 classrooms are functioning in every village, right? You know, to start with roads, start with 30 kilometers of dual carriageway first, right? And move that to 100. And before you know it, the whole country is covered. We were in Aba, and we met a governorship candidate of Abga in Aba. In Abia. We met somewhere close. And he said before he ran for office, he brought in South Africans to measure how many roads are there in the city of Aba. Turns out that they're not up to 1,000 kilometers of, you know, in the streets in the city. But you go to Aba today, it's one of the dirtiest places in the Southeast. And they keep pumping in money there. Instead of fixing the roads, the governor of Abia, prefer to put signboards all over the place. Imo is even worse. Imo is governed by Rochas Okorocha. That one goes to all, anywhere he finds a corrupt president, he'll come and erect a statue for him in his state. Yes, there's a statue for Zuma in Imo State. There's a statue for the woman who just finished her tenure in Liberia, Ellis, is it? Yes. You know, if they hadn't stopped him, he would have erected a statue for Anini, the former armed robber from Edo State, what used to be known as the Bendel State. These are the kind of jokers running our system. So the question we should ask ourselves is, for how long are we going to continue this nonsense? And in coming to the diaspora, we are not only looking for your financial support, we are looking for your influence. And I can't say it enough, beside oil, the highest source of revenue for Nigeria are you people from the diaspora. That's, yes, oil fetches, you know, maybe about $30 billion. Something a little bit more. I think our budget is about $35 billion a year. The diaspora brings in about $50 billion every year, just officially, right? But you don't even have a right to vote. But at least you have a right to call somebody at home and say, look, this is the person I want you to vote for. You have a right to support your candidate. And people listen to you, whether you like it or not. Each time you make a call, you probably have 10 people you can call to make the right decision. And the results are coming in in a very, very interesting way to us. Everywhere we go, people will stop us and say, the only reason I'm voting for you is because my brother called me from Texas. So they said you are the best candidate. We didn't even know this. There are people who have been directly sponsored by the diaspora. They have adopted a lot of local campaigners for us, and we run into them all the time. They don't even know us. They just said, well, my brother asked me to be working for you. Already now, a lot of diasporans have contributed money and are supporting people who are already waiting to become polling unit agents for us. Adopt a local government, you can adopt a ward, you can adopt a state, and start working with them directly without even contacting us. But we are here tonight for a different purpose. We are here to raise funds directly so that we can support the campaign in such a way that even if we cannot match them money for money, we can match them with ideas, with little money. We are running a very, very lean campaign. Very lean campaign, but our campaign has been so effective such that very soon, I'm sure they will be learning how we did it in universities across Nigeria. And I'm not bragging, you know, because the reason is that even the major candidates are wondering how we became so popular within such a short time with no money. How much have we raised so far? Officially, we've raised from GoFundMe about $104,000. But that's a lot of money. You know, nobody in the history of Nigeria has ever raised money publicly on GoFundMe like we did. There was a governorship candidate for Baze, I think from Anambra State. He raised about $23,000. And we are the only ones, even among the younger candidates, who announce on a daily basis or a regular basis how much we are making. So we also set up a Nigerian account, Zenit Bank, where we raised over 40 million naira. So what we raised on GoFundMe is about 36 million naira. But our local account has actually received more money from GoFundMe. So there's a challenge to you in the diaspora, for those of you who are using GoFundMe, to beat people at home. Because now you have woken them up and they are way ahead of you in terms of contributions we are getting from our Naira account as well. So between our Naira account and our GoFundMe account, we are right now close to 80 million Naira from the public that we've raised. But we've also received a lot of donations for people who are donating their homes, they are donating their roofs, they are donating cars. We just received 2 vehicles donated 3 days ago or thereabout from a guy who sends vehicles to Nigeria. So say before I sell them, you can use them after you're done, send it back, I'll sell them. We have people who donate. We just had the 15 megaphones donated from a guy who already donated another 15. So you can do all kinds of things to help the campaign become the new idea in Nigeria. As I have continuously stated, this is not only a revolutionary idea, but this is going to bring about a revolution in Nigeria. I'm not afraid to say it. What I'll say here, finally, and I know this is my second finally. But I mean it this time. Is that there is a way that we can also engage with people who are not here. There are a lot of people who are still haven't made up their mind whether they want Nigeria to be truly free or not. So many of them are not sure. A lot of people are torn between the depression of the politics of the past, and they are very anxious about the future. So they don't know. A lot of them will see us and say, how are we sure that if you get there, you will not be the same kind of persons we have been dealing with? What we tell them and what you should tell them is, look at the history of the person you are dealing with. Look at his pedigree. Look at his interventions politically. You don't need to wonder that there's a difference between a Sowore and an Atiku or Buhari, or the two of them combined together, Butiku. these are the same people, they belong to the same political party, branded in the front with different names, the same ideology. The ideology is still in. Today, if you have a chance, go on Facebook, or you can find it on online. One of them, Donald Duke, came out with a revelation. It's been on, but it's now going around. And he said, the reason I cannot support Atiku is that everybody is, no, the reason he cannot even, he didn't want to be a flag bearer for PDP. He said, even if I'm PDP flag bearer, I cannot succeed in Nigeria. He said, there are too many thieves in PDP. And when I hear from Donald Duke, Donald Duke used to be part of them. And I'm sure he's still part of them. I'm not saying, he's not a retired thief. I've confronted him before. But for him to come out and say that, that tells you that there is epiphany also reigning in the minds of the thieves themselves. They are now coming out to confess to the Nigerian people that if you don't vote for any of us, because as I have said, if Atiku becomes Nigeria's next president, he will put Nigeria on eBay. They will auction Nigeria off. It's as simple as that. And they are not pretending at all. You can see, look at who is going to be Atiku. Atiku will be president. Saraki will be Senate president again. You know, I mean, Benga Daniel is going to be a minister. All the indicted thieves in Nigeria, they are going to be there. But the same thing goes for Buhari as well. His wife came out also and confessed that Buhari is being held to ransom by two people. How can 15 million people vote for somebody and two people will hold him to ransom? And what I said to them on my Facebook page is, Nigerians should work with us. I will help you fire the two people who are holding him to ransom and the man himself, so that all of them can go and hold themselves to ransom in Dara, his hometown. So ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. If you give yourself a round of applause. You continue to make me proud, and you know, when you ask sometimes where do I get the energy from, I get it from all of you. That's why you're always tired. Thank you. Thank you. So MC, I want to also say something quickly about our MC, and it has to do with how we get, you know, the question people ask us, who are the people who will work with you when you become president? Some of you have heard about our DG, his name is Malcolm Fabi. He came out of the University of Lagos with the first class and now has a PhD. In fact, he got his PhD, I think, before he became 30 years old. Yeah, and he's an expert. This man beside me is also Pomelo Loyede. He was also a student union president at the University of Lagos.
Yes.
He also has a PhD, right? PhD. And he, I told earlier, I said he made a first class, but he followed me, and so he dropped to 2-1. That's why, you know, parents used to warn their kids not to follow me at the University of Lagos. Yeah. But everybody that followed us are doing well today, you know. I don't want to disclose to you which class I made, because so that you guys will not be discouraged not to name your children after me. But these are some of the fantastic guys that we can't wait to bring back to Nigeria. And all of you here, your skill set. Nigeria is just waiting for all of you to come back to it and fix the place. The good news we have is, and part of the reason you see us coming back and forth with you with this engagement, is that the Human Resource Department of Nigeria will be flowing with people who have, you know, free services to offer, but have the best skills around the world. So it's going to be a matter of time before we get to the moon, as soon as we have the right leaders. But without putting the right leaders in position of authority, without electing the right people, Nigeria is not going anywhere. We are not even going to send a flying sauce into the air. It's not possible with this kind of characters that are parading themselves. And if we don't get it right now, well, too bad for us. So thank you once again, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Take it.
Back.
Take it.
Back.
AC.
Action.
So I just wanted to ask you, like, what do you think that's going to be like, you know, what is going to be the difference, like, from the change that happened in 1999 versus the change that's going to happen now with you being the one that's there? What do you think the main change is going to be?
One of the critical things to look at is, it was 1999, there was a transition from military to civilian role, whatever you want to call it.
So why would you say that was not, like, that was not complete? Because I think, like, from listening to you, that's what you indicate, that it
wasn't. Yeah, it wasn't complete.
Because you think it was just a formality?
It was a formality.
Okay.
You know, and it was not inclusive. There was a lot of people who did not have an understanding of a constitutional, you know, setting for a democratic. So people thought maybe it was also going to be another look. Because the military had got so many of those traditions before them. What is important this time around is that next year will be 20 years exactly after that happened. And most importantly, there is a clamor for generational change. You know, I say all the time.
There's a clamor for generational change because
Of the ideas that have been put in the democratic process in 1999. Ideas of the same people who sabotage the democracy forever. So look at Obasanjo, who was president of Nigeria's military in 77. He came back 77, 78, 79. He came back 1999 as president. You know, after that, you know,
why did they choose him? Why didn't they choose somebody different?
Because the country did not look
the
ruling class. Did not. They had a grip on the process and did not give up power. They only gave space for the new system of government.
Do you believe that once the change happens for Nigeria, it'll happen for all of Africa too?
What is holding the rest of Africa to us?
It's Nigeria.
Right?
So why? I mean, people see Nigerians all over the world making such progress and doing so many big things with their lives, and then they wonder, why is Nigeria so messed up? If Nigerians all over the world able to do these things in other places, do you think that's going to be a lot different?
Nigerians who should have made this happen have for too long neglected and ignored.
Do you think they neglected and ignored the country because they found it too challenging? Because it looked like a big a dragon that no one could slay.
A lot of people just get scared.
Yeah.
What
they're going to face. Same certain things, the consequence of saying certain things.
And the same people who try to do something, like what happened to them.
So why do you think you're like, you know, the person for this task? Well, to really bring it.
I think it's been over the years that my only engagement with the process, the Nigerian governance process, has been to change it since I started as a university student activist.
Yeah.
And that process hasn't changed. When I came to the US, it's similar thing, you know, in setting up a media company that is exposing corruption, you know, and engaging in protests and exposing multinational corporations.
You know, I came to know Adeola Faye, I did before you, right?
Yeah.
I came across you accidentally when I was actually.
Exactly, because I was the guy in the background who set up the company that
did really well.
Amplified her voice and her talent, yes. So, and she's doing very well.
Yeah. No, when I started watching your videos, I couldn't stop.
So this has been it, you know, is that, you know, I've developed myself, and this is that I've developed an understanding of the problem. I've solved so many problems.
And you're not afraid?
No, it's too late to be afraid.
I like that. It's too late to be afraid.
It's too late. So I'm not afraid, and, you know, as I tell people, there's no one in Nigeria that's safe, whether you're engaging in.
But you're lucky you're abroad. What makes it worth it for you to go back? Why are you not trying to get your citizenship here? Why are you not trying to just stay here? It's just not worth it to you.
Because I also have a consciousness of understanding that I'm a stranger anywhere else but there. And, you know, so
there's something about being at home that's really like in your soul.
And I tell you, Nigeria is a beautiful place.
It is. It has a beautiful heart.
Yeah. It does not have.
Yeah.
And more
time we get it right, you all become the Lord.
But I think we were meant to infect the rest of the world anyway.
And that's what we're
so that's why it's happened.
Not that it's true, but at home. I just can't open that home.
All right.
Yes.
Thank you, sir. So thank you so much.
Yes. Accept my fault.
Huh?
Accept my apology for the interruption.
Oh, no, it's okay. No, it's okay.
You're the one I want though. Before my liver start to fail, you're the one I need though. Before cassava start to hail, and if I ever leave oh.